This video is sponsored by Magellan TV. Pulsars are the most energetic stellar objects in the universe. We think of them as cosmic lighthouses, sweeping twin beams of radiation as they rotate up to hundreds of times a second. These beams emerge from the magnetic poles, which are thought to lie in opposing hemispheres of the star. But astronomers using NASA's NICER telescope created the first ever maps of a pulsar 1,100 light years away. They found that the magnetic fields of pulsars are even more strange than previously thought. Welcome back to Launchpad. I'm Christian Reddy, your friendly neighborhood astronomer. In our previous video on neutron stars, pulsars, and magnetars, we learned that they form when the cores of massive stars collapse, setting off a supernova. These objects are so mind-bogglingly dense, protons and electrons are squeezed together to create neutrons. A neutron star is essentially a giant atomic nucleus more massive than the Sun, yet squeezed into a sphere the size of a city. Understanding the conditions inside neutron stars is one of the greatest mysteries in physics. Their interiors are thought to consist of exotic states of superfluid neutrons and superconducting protons, but the most extreme conditions lie at the core and remain unknown. To understand them requires pushing the boundaries of our understanding of quantum mechanics. Now, quantum mechanics is a fascinating but mind-bending subject. If you'd like to learn more about it, I'm happy to recommend The Secrets of Quantum Physics, a two-part documentary available on Magellan TV, who are very kindly sponsoring today's video. Magellan TV is a new streaming service which dives deep into diverse subjects including history, nature, and of course my favorites, space and science. New programs are added every week and are streamed without interruptions, ads, or limitations on access. You can enjoy Magellan TV on your Apple TV, Amazon Fire, Roku, laptop, and even your iOS and Android devices. Best of all, you can enjoy much of Magellan TV's content in beautiful 4K. As long as we're staying inside, we may as well enjoy the content that not only entertains us, but makes us a little smarter as well. That's why I'm delighted to tell you that Magellan TV has an exclusive offer for Launchpad Astronomy viewers if you follow this online link, where you will get a one-month trial absolutely free. Please make sure to use the link in the description of this video. Neutron stars rotate ridiculously fast, up to hundreds of times a second. This creates ultra-powerful magnetic fields that are so strong they actually rip particles off the star's surface. These particles race along the magnetic field lines until they slam back onto the surface at the magnetic poles. This heats up the poles so much that they give off X-rays, and these X-ray hotspots mark the launch points of the twin beams of radiation. Typically, the magnetic axis is tilted with respect to the neutron star's rotation axis, so the beams of radiation rotate with the star like a cosmic lighthouse. When the beams sweep along our line of sight, we detect them as pulsars. At least, that's the canonical model of pulsars as rotating magnetic dipoles. Or put another way, super-spinning power zombie bar magnets. But much about neutron stars remains enshrouded in mystery, especially their interiors. To that end, the Neutron Star Interior Composition Explorer, or NICER, was installed on the International Space Station in 2017. NICER uses an array of 56 detectors to record the precise energy levels and arrival times of individual X-ray photons to an accuracy of just 100 nanoseconds. That's 20 times more accurate than previous X-ray timing observatories. Astronomers can use this information to build up a map of the X-ray hotspots on a pulsar and then work backward to model its interior. This is a technique called pulse profile modeling, and in a way, it's similar to how geologists use seismic data to model the interior of Earth. But in the case of a pulsar, one must also account for things like how the temperature varies around the star's surface, how the radiation is transferred in the stellar atmosphere, and how light rays from the pulsar get distorted in its strong gravity. Pulsars are so dense, their gravity warps the fabric of space-time around them. This has the effect of letting us see parts of the pulsar's far side. To see what I mean, imagine a pulsar about 8 miles in radius, but with far less mass. We'd see the object at its actual size and only the light coming from the near side of the pulsar. But if we let the mass increase, the pulsar's gravity warps spacetime and bends light from the far side toward us. The more massive the pulsar gets, the more it warps spacetime, and the more of the far side we can see. This means the hotspots may never quite disappear from view, but the light from the far side would be slightly delayed as it had to travel a longer distance toward us. This creates a subtle difference in the timing of the arriving X-rays. Astronomers can take advantage of this effect to infer things like the pulsar's mass, its radius, and the location of the hotspots. From 2017 to 2018, NICER examined the pulsar PSR J0030 plus 0451. J0030 is an isolated pulsar about 1,100 light-years away in the constellation Pisces. Its rotation period is just 4.87 milliseconds. In other words, it rotates more than 205 times a second. This puts J0030 in a special class of fast-rotating millisecond pulsars. As J0030 spun, its X-ray flux was precisely measured by NICER. Two teams of astronomers worked independently to infer the pulsar's properties from the NICER data. It turns out both teams got very similar results. One team, based in the United States, estimated the pulsar at 1.34 solar masses and 12.71 kilometers in radius. A second team, based in the Netherlands, got a similar result of 1.44 solar masses and a radius of 13.02 kilometers. Now, these are the most precise measurements yet of a pulsar's mass and size to an uncertainty of less than 10%. That puts J0030 toward the lower end of the pulsar mass range, which is thought to range between 1.1 and 2.6 solar masses. Now, by the way, a little side note here. In our previous video on neutron stars, we talked about how they form from the collapse of a massive star when its white dwarf reaches 1.4 solar masses. This is the Chandrasekhar limit above which electron degeneracy pressure can no longer hold the core up against its own gravity, and the core collapses to form a neutron star or even a black hole. So how can a neutron star have a mass lower than the Chandrasekhar limit? Well, after it forms, the surrounding layers of the dying star slam down onto the core surface, setting off the supernova. But when all of that mass collides onto the neutron star, a significant amount gets converted into pure energy in accordance with Einstein's famous equation E equals mc squared. Thus, a significant fraction of the core's mass gets annihilated, and the resulting neutron star can weigh less than the Chandrasekhar limit. To that end, the teams not only weighed the pulsar, but they also determined that we're viewing it from above its north rotational pole at an inclination of about 54 degrees. But when it came to mapping the hotspots, the data didn't fit the traditional model of a magnetic dipole. Instead, both teams found that both hotspots were coming from the pulsar's southern hemisphere. It gets even weirder than that. The team led by researchers at the University of Amsterdam suggests that J0030 has one small circular spot and an elongated crescent-shaped spot both surrounding the south rotational pole. The other team led by researchers at the Universities of Maryland and Illinois got a similar result with two oval hotspots on either side of the south pole. Now, these spots have similar shapes and locations as the one found by the Dutch team, but the American team found a third, cooler spot just slightly offset from the pulsar's south pole. This third spot was barely detected just at the edge of our view of the pulsar. Both are extremely weird results and look nothing like the classical magnetic dipole model. So does this mean that our understanding of pulsars is fundamentally wrong? Well, researchers who study pulsars would be the first to tell you that the traditional dipole model doesn't satisfactorily explain all of the observational pulsar phenomena over the last 50 plus years. Higher order magnetic multipoles have been proposed to explain different pulsar observations, but the resulting magnetic fields are much more complex and require numerical simulations that can only be done on supercomputers. However, the NICER data revealed two distinct repeating pulse components, so both teams were able to test models with two hot regions on the star surface while varying their location and shape to include ovals and crescents. The fact that both results are similar to each other strongly suggests that there's a real, non-canonical magnetic dipole on J0030. But everything else about the pulsar, its timing behavior, its gamma ray output, its X-ray properties, and radio pulsations are all typical of millisecond pulsars. And that suggests that what we're seeing in J0030 might not be all that unusual for millisecond pulsars. And that has some very interesting implications. Perhaps the pulsar started off with a typical dipole that somehow got shunted way off from the center down to the pulsar's southern hemisphere. Such offset magnetic fields are not uncommon in nature. For example, planets Uranus and Neptune in our own solar system have offset magnetic fields as well. Another possibility is that J0030 is undergoing a change in its magnetic field. Pulsars do evolve over time, often slowing down as their magnetic fields drag against the interstellar medium. Although how it results in a magnetic field implied by these results isn't exactly clear. Perhaps its polarity is reversing. The Sun undergoes a polarity reversal during every 11-year sunspot cycle. Perhaps J0030 is undergoing some sort of temporary magnetic realignment. Now, J0030 is only the first pulsar to be modeled to this level of detail. NICER is investigating other pulsars, and it'll be interesting to see how their hotspot and magnetic configurations compare. Over time, a better picture of the evolution of pulsars will emerge, along with a better understanding of their interiors. If you want to learn more about the difference between neutron stars, pulsars, millisecond pulsars, and magnetars, I invite you to check out this video when we're done here. I'd also like to thank my Patreon supporters for helping to keep this channel going, and I want to welcome my newest patrons, Chris Frampton, Larry Ross, and Synergy. And a special thanks as always to my cosmological patron, Michael Dowling. If you'd like to help support Launchpad for the price of a cup of coffee every month, well, please check out my Patreon page. And if you'd like to join me on this journey through this incredible universe of ours, well, please make sure that you subscribe and ring that notification bell so that you don't miss out on any new videos. Until next time, stay home, stay healthy, and stay curious, my friends.